Well, good morning, Elston Family Church. It's a beautiful spring morning out. You know, I'm telling you, when I let the dogs out, it's nice to have sunshine and be able to wear my shades on my drive-in. It's pretty great. I'm Angela Hunt, and I am here to welcome you guys here in the house, but those watching online. I serve on staff here at Elston. We have our worship team up here, led by Ron and Rebecca-ish, I think it was a combination. And we're going to hear a great word from Dennis Renner this morning, who serves on campus as a missionary and a pastor for international students. So it's a good word. I got to listen to it first service, and I'll be taking more notes this service. A couple of announcements before we get into worship. One related to Celebrate Recovery. That is a ministry that meets here every Friday evening with dinner at 6:30 and large group, our main meeting at 7 with childcare and a student ministry as well. We do have Celebrate Recovery step studies going on right now. They're meeting on Tuesdays and are still open for newcomers. So what's a 12-step study? Well, it's where men meet with men here in the sanctuary and the ladies are meeting back in the youth room as a small group, walk through the 8 biblical principles and the 12 steps of recovery. So if you have any questions about that, or if you're praying about it and you feel sort of that nudge we get from the Holy Spirit, you know what I'm talking about, that thing in your gut, feel free to touch base with me or any of the other Celebrate Recovery leaders, and we would love to answer those questions and talk you through that. This week is spring break, so it's good to see all of you non-travelers like myself home in Indiana for the week of spring break, or maybe some of you are leaving later. But Wednesday night activities, both the Deep and the prayer meeting, will not be meeting this Wednesday. So if you are in town, link up with some friends or hang out with your family and have a great family night at home. Also, youth camp deposits, though, for students that attend the Deep are due this week. I think they're $100. You are welcome to mail that in here to the church, drop it off during the week, or if you have it this morning, place it in one of the offering boxes around the building, and we'll get you all taken care of. All right, so let's all take a breath. And we're going to rise together and go into a time of worship this morning. And as I was coming in, some words from Paul from Romans chapter 15 came to my mind that really sort of set the stage for why we're here today. And he writes to us, "May God, who gives this patience and encouragement, help you live in complete harmony with each other, as is fitting for followers of Christ Jesus. Then all of you," capital letters all, I'm making those capital letters all for us, "all of you can join together with one voice, giving praise and glory to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ." So worship, and let's bless the Lord together. Amen.
that you've done for me.
Who brings our chaos?
Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of Glory, the King of Glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of Glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, you've done for me.
Amazing grace.
to shake. The stone was rolled away. His perfect love could not be overcome. Now death, where is your sting? Our resurrected King has rendered you defeated. Forever He is glorified. Forever He is lifted high. Forever He is risen. He is alive. He is alive. Forever He is glorified. Forever He is lifted high. Forever He is risen. He is alive. He is alive.
Grab me again, shake.
The ground began to shake. The stone was rolled away. His perfect love could not be overcome. Now death, where is your sting? Our resurrected King has rendered you defeated. Forever He is glorified. Forever He is lifted high. Forever He is risen. He is alive. He is alive. Forever He is glorified. Forever He is lifted high. Forever He is risen. He is alive. He is
we sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb has overcome. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb has overcome. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb is overcome. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb is overcome.
See you.
We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb has overcome. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb has overcome. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb has overcome. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb has overcome.
Almighty God, King of kings, sovereign Lord, Abba Father, let us never forget the trouble, the utter lostness, the taste of ashes, the poison we've swallowed, the sin we were buried in. Let us remember it and remember it well, that feeling of right before you came into our life. Because while we remember that, there's one more thing that we can remember. And that's what we're going to hold on to. It's that unfailing love and mercy of yours, God. That grace, that mercy that's fresh every morning. It never, ever ends. You are so faithful to us, Father, in that. So we're going to stick this life out on this side of heaven with you. We're going to keep our eyes upward on you and our feet following in the steps of Jesus Christ so that we look less like this world and more like your Son, Jesus Christ, through the power of the Holy Spirit that he so graciously left behind with us. Because Father, you knew there would be a time, there would be these circumstances, that all we have left is to hold on to you. So Father, that is why we sing to you. That is why we bless you with our praises. That is why we come together as your people, as brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ, through the power of the Holy Spirit, this unexplainable, mysterious, vast love. We honor you for that. We love you. Abba, Father, we need your Holy Spirit to pour itself over this place, to rain down like fire deep into our guts where our journey with you began. So as we continue to praise, we will praise you in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living.
Yeah.
Jesus have found their home. The orphans now have a home. All that was lost has found its place in you.
Amen.
You lift our
that may be bringing us closer to you, stepping into your will. For some of us that may be crossing over from death to life. God, we pray that you prepare our hearts. We will lean into whatever it is you have for us this morning. Open our eyes and ears to see and hear the message that you have for us, Lord. Pray over Brother Dennis as he comes to bring the message from the Lord. I pray that you anoint him and you put your hand on him. We're so thankful you are here. Continue to dwell. Continue to change us. We know that you will be faithful to finish the work that you've started this morning. We love you, God, and we thank you for everything. In the name of your mighty Son, Jesus Christ, whom we all adore. Amen.
Good morning. Let me give you the privilege to share this morning, and actually I'll share next week as well. But this has been one of those interesting weeks. I got started on Tuesday, typing out my message, trying to get all laid out and everything. And it's up to about 7 pages, and my laptop decided to do an update without my permission, and I forgot to save, so I lost 4 pages. Right off on Tuesday. Wednesday, came down with a sore throat, ended up being a cold, so hence, that's the mask. Normally, we don't do masks, and also, my voice is down an octave. It normally isn't this low. Probably by the end of the week, or next week, I'll be down to a Barry White, those who don't know who that is. Way down low. So, not complaining, just sharing that that's life, that's reality sometimes. So, today, we're going to talk about our present hope. And what does that mean? Next week, we're going to look at our future hope. And what does that mean? So let's pray. And then again, for me, and then we will get this rolling. Father, we thank you for this time. Thank you, Lord, for those who are present and those who are online. Lord, I pray that it's your word that speaks out today. That even with few words, that, Lord, we can be challenged, we can be changed. But it's all by the power of your Spirit. And so, Lord, I pray that in spite of me, Lord, your word will speak clearly. Just pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. So I don't know about you guys, but the pandemic has worn out its welcome. Not that it really had a welcome, but it's definitely worn out its welcome. But one of the things I've tried to do through this process is to evaluate what have we learned? What has it exposed for all of us? For myself, for my family, for others, for the church? What impact has it had? So these are my observations, okay? For myself, I've learned as an introvert, I do hang out with people. I do like people, but I'm not your life of the party type of person. But I can't stand these masks. If I could take them off, I'd take them off now. Because it has impacted relationships. It's impacted get to know people. It's hard to have a relationship behind a mask. That's the reality. I was sharing in the first service that, back in the Western days, people who put a mask over their face were coming to do evil, right? And so I think there is a level of trust. I work with international students on campus, and so to not see the person's face, there's an issue of relationship that goes there. And so even understanding, communicating, all those things have an impact. So I'm ready to see people's faces. I appreciate coming to church when we all get to see our faces. Here, I'll take my mask off for a second and put it back on. For my family, for us, we've appreciated the time that has brought us back together. We've really appreciated being together as a family. Our family nights, my adult children have dedicated that time for us in their busy schedules and our busy schedules. And so it's really caused us to appreciate being together as a family. For others, this is where it gets a little harder. I've seen this heightened level of tension and frustration and even depression that we've seen the division of extremes begin to occur between carelessness versus fear. And when these two collide, it's troublesome. We've got new phrases that have come out of all this, Karen and Ken, because this tension happens between people. And I think it's part of this pandemic. And it's hard to find that middle ground of compassion and care, which we all really should be doing. For the church, the capital C church, I've observed kind of a similar thing, in all honesty. Our attitudes haven't been as different as it ought to be between the world and how we should be acting. We struggle with that idea of how, you know, is someone being careless? Is somebody being fearful? How do we bridge those gaps and show compassion and care towards one another? But it's beginning to affect us. Here's a statement from a gentleman named Joe Wright. He works with small churches and bivocational pastors throughout the Southern Baptist world. And here's a quote from him. He says, "We are hearing just across the nation of pastors and churches both struggling. We're seeing just the stress of trying to do ministry in this kind of environment, and it's taking a toll on pastors and church leaders." Another church blogger, he predicts that the majority of attenders may no longer be in the room when this is all over. That's a huge shift for pastors and church leaders. I don't know this is going to happen to Elson. That's not a prediction here. I think it may not be. But it's a reality to other churches. And there's a struggle there. The division within the church has grown so much to a point that it's leaving pastors in the middle. Do we wear masks? Do we not wear masks? In person, online. Do we shake hands and hug, or do we elbow? And other creative issues. These are stresses that pastors and church leaders are under. I'm a campus minister at Purdue, and we have faced similar circumstances, trying to provide online access to students who can't be here physically when we have our weekly time, and others who are physically present on campus but don't want to come and be with our group because of the virus and their fear. But it's still a challenge, because I know as a church leader or someone who's well on campus, we want that in-person relationship, but we have to be respectful and show compassion. But above everything else, the most prevalent issue facing people today that every single person, especially adults, we've either gone through it or we're getting ready to go into it or we're in it, and that is depression or being depressed, having depressed thinking. It's an enemy that affects us all. So it even affected people in the scriptures. In the scriptures, we had people like Naomi. In the book of Ruth, we had David, King David, Jeremiah, Elijah, and others who expressed these same feelings of being depressed. So please hear me right now. It is not a sin to have those thoughts. But this is not a message of permission either. Okay? I want this to challenge all of us. And I hope it will. But let me make this point very clear. If you have been clinically or medically diagnosed with depression, in your own medication, follow your doctor's orders, okay? I'm not trying to tell you to walk away from anything of that nature. However, let this be a part of your journey. Let this be an encouragement that there's hope on the other side. We have hope. Okay, so get out your analog or digital Bibles. Sorry, I'm an audio-video kind of guy, so I like to say analog or digital. So we will have the scriptures up on the screen as well. We're just going to look at one verse today. We're going to turn to 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3. Here's the verse. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. So we're going to work our way through this verse. I know that's kind of strange. Sometimes we are ready in our own personal reading, or we don't really like to slow down with one verse. Be thankful I'm not doing Jesus Wept, the shortest verse in the Bible. But this has a lot packed into it. This has so much that we can take and apply to our lives to show us the hope that we have. So we're going to take this verse by verse, or statement, or sentence. We're going to break it down. First things first, we're going to look at that first sentence. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. All right. First things first. First word, blessed. Often we hear the word blessed. When we think of the word blessed, we immediately are thinking of the Beatitudes. We want to turn to Matthew 5, and we want to go through all those different Beatitudes. In the scriptures, that word that's used in the gospel, in the Sermon on the Mount, is translated as happy or fortunate or well off. But here in 1 Peter, it's a different direction. So in the Beatitudes, the blessed is a coming down. But here, it's an adoration. It's a going up. And so when we think about this word, blessed be the God, we're being asked to bless God. How many in here have ever thought about that idea of blessing God? Typically, we say, bless you. Someone sneezes, we'll give that bless you, which has some weird origination to that. You know, there's two or three different views on that. Some believe that you were actually expelling your soul, that the Pope said, bless you, you know, that you're not getting rid of your soul. Some believe that you were casting out an evil spirit onto somebody else. So it's kind of a, hey, stop it, you know, type of idea. Others believe that, and there's a little bit of truth. Some believe that your heart actually stops. And so there was a sense of blessing. It doesn't stop. To some people, it may have to recalibrate for a second, but it's not a situation that your heart will actually come to an end. But there was thoughts of that. So we're looking at this idea of blessing God. So it's not going to be when God sneezes, but it's going to be about when is God acting in your life, and when is God involved in your life, and when is he not? Well, the answer is God is always involved in your life. So we're going to have these two-word phrases going, building as we go through our message today. So our first phrase is bless God. So we'll keep building on that. Look at our next verse, next portion. The God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Without clarity, if we were just to read this verse, it could lead us down some bad paths if we're not clear on our understanding of that we worship a triune God. We don't worship multiple gods. This is addressing both the first two persons of the Trinity. In older translations, older manuscripts, they don't even have the word "and." They'll put just a comma. So it's a descriptor. So it's the God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. And so we're identifying the Father, and we're identifying Lord Jesus Christ. Here's an important doctrinal statement. Jesus came to restore us to the Father. That's the relationship. That's how important things are. The triune God who created everything, set this whole thing up, sent Jesus, the second person of the Trinity, to come down and to restore and redeem us back to the Father. In 2 Corinthians 5:17, it says this, 17 through 20. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. All this is from God, who through Jesus, through Christ, reconciled us to himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, God making his appeal through us. We implore you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. Okay, so understand the relationship between the two. We need to identify or understand this whole thing of Lord Jesus Christ. I'm going to let a guy named Matthew Henry, a famous theologian of old, explain it. He just says, here are the three names of one person, denoting his threefold office. One, he is Lord, a universal king or sovereign. Jesus, as priest or savior. Christ, a prophet anointed with the Spirit and furnished with all gifts necessary for the instruction, guidance, and salvation of his church. That's how important this big first opening sentence is. Bless God. He is the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. All right, we're going to keep moving through our phrases. Next thing, our next phrase is according to his great mercy. Here, Peter's using, he's given a further reason to bless God. He is expounding on what this means. But typically, when we read the idea of mercy, those who grew up in the church, we don't really camp out on mercy. We usually camp out on grace. Mercy is not receiving what you deserve. Okay? Grace is receiving what you didn't deserve, or receiving what you didn't earn. You're getting something in exchange. We tend to get camped on, we want to stick with grace. God's riches at Christ's expense. That's the acronym that we grew up being taught. Mercy is something we really, we might say as a slang, Lord, have mercy. I mean, we don't want to get what we deserve. We deserve hell. I hate to tell you, the truth is, left to ourselves, we deserve hell. We rebel against God. We rebel against his commands. We don't want his authority in our life. That's not our instinct. Our instinct is to rebel. If we understand that God's mercy, if we understand that it is by God's mercy, as followers of Jesus, professing him as Lord and Savior, we are not getting what we deserve. We deserve hell. Our sin, our offenses against God demand justice by God because of his holiness and his laws. But praise be to God, according to his grace, he sent Jesus. That's the grace. So right now, I'm going to stop, and we're going to bless God before we go any further, because he deserves the blessing. So let's pray again. Father, we give you the blessing because you are magnificent. You're our creator. You're our king. You sustain us. You're a provider. You're everything that we need, even when we don't know what we need. You are enough. So, Lord, we bless you right now, and we give you that praise and honor and glory. In Jesus' name we say this. Amen. Okay, let's keep walking through this verse. Our next phrase is our ultimate reason for blessing God. He has caused us to be born again. Okay, so some could get hung up on that word caused. If you want to go down some different theological rabbit holes, you can go down some different crazy ways. But I look at this as a cause and effect. We're all familiar with cause and effect. Something happens, this is the effect of it. This is the cause and effect. When we understand and apply, in the book of Romans, the second half of chapter 10, it talks about that who will be saved unless someone goes and proclaims the gospel. That's how we will know. If you're a born-again believer right now, you're born-again believer because someone preached the gospel to you. whether by little, a big message, little message. For me, I was sitting on the bed with my mom. You know, she didn't get up and preach, you know, or that's not her way. But she made the gospel clear in preaching. So if you are a child of God, someone preached the gospel to you. So that's the cause. The cause is the preaching. The cause is hearing the message. We don't become believers by osmosis, by just, it's out there and you thought about it. Because in your own person, in your own mind, that's not where you're going to go. That is not your natural instinct. Your natural instinct is to rebel. I tell some students that when I'm having gospel conversations with them, that you don't have to teach a child to lie. A child will instinctively lie out of self-preservation. You don't have to teach them that. It shows that we're born with a sin nature that causes us to rebel. All right, so that's the word caused. To be born again, this word born again is a churchy word, if you want to say, but it is found in the scriptures. It's found in John chapter 3, the famous John 3:16 comes from the conversation that Jesus had with Nicodemus, a religious leader. And he gives them this illustration. He said, well, here's his actual words. He says, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. So, of course, Nicodemus, an older gentleman, is baffled and confused by this statement and says, well, how in the world can somebody old go back into his mom's tummy or stomach or womb? That's impossible. And so I could understand that kind of conclusion. That would be kind of a weird conclusion or imagery that Jesus gives. I like the idea of a seed to understand this idea of being born again. A seed is produced by a plant. In order for the seed to do what it needs to do, it has to die in order to be reborn. So Jesus used this. He used the same illustration later on in John 12. It says, truly, truly, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Whoever loves his life loses it. And whoever hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. So Paul also used this idea of death to life back in that 2 Corinthians text we looked at. So to be born again is referring to the need of spiritual rebirth. It's recognizing that we're stuck eternally in our rebellion against God, despising his authority over our lives, and understanding that if we want to be in his presence now and after this life, we need help. We need something we could not do for ourselves. That's why Jesus came. Jesus came to fulfill everything we couldn't. Here's what I mean. God demanded perfection. Jesus was and is perfect. God demanded holiness. Jesus is pure. God is just. Jesus took our punishment for our sin. God is love. Jesus showed us their love. Jesus' life, death, burial, and resurrection fulfill everything we couldn't do for ourselves. His life fulfilled the law. His death fulfilled the need for a sacrifice because of sin. His burial fulfilled that death is the punishment for sin. But his resurrection fulfilled his role as conqueror. He is the conqueror over death and sin, providing us with eternal life, now and forever. This is where hope begins to reveal itself. Let's go back to our text. The next little phrase causes us to be born again to a living hope. A living hope. So we're building our phrases here. We have born again. I'm sorry. Bless God, born again, and living hope. I hope you'll just take those little six words and use it for your own encouragement. But what in the world is a living hope? Paul gives a little clarity, and then we're going to look at some other verses here, but Paul has the clarity to finish up the verse saying, through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Jesus Christ's resurrection is that living hope. Because of Jesus, because our Jesus is alive, conquering death through his resurrection, causing us to be born again, we have a living hope. Hope provides certainty. Hope provides confidence in something outside of us. In Hebrews 11:1, it says, now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. So what is our hope? Here's some different verses you can write down if you want to look at them later. Galatians 5:5 says, for through the Spirit, by faith, we ourselves eagerly wait for the hope of righteousness. In Romans 8:24-25 says, for in this hope we were saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope. For who hopes for what he sees? But we hope for what we do not see. We wait for it with patience. And earlier in Romans, he wrote, Romans 5:1-5 says, therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Through him, we have also obtained access by faith into this grace in which we stand. And we rejoice in hope of the glory of God. Not only that, but we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. I was saying earlier how the week can be crazy. It was crazy for me. God gave a blessing on Friday night. We were at church watching my daughter. She directed a play. And a Chinese man was there that I had known a few years ago and had some conversations, and our workers had conversations with him, fellow staff members. But I've been watching as he's kind of floated around to different Christian ministries and churches and such. And he was actually there with another Christian family. And so I started a conversation with him, and it was a very interesting conversation. Part of it, he is trying to see if our messages are the same. Are we all communicating the same thing, or is there contradiction? So had to kind of deal a little gingerly with that, because he had visited a Catholic church, and he had visited the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, the Mormons. And having to explain, that's no bueno. I didn't say no bueno. That's Spanish. He speaks Chinese, so that wasn't going to work. But I said, you can't. And I had to explain to him what the differences of the gospel was. And he said, well, what does it take to be a Christian? And so I said, well, it's very simple. Romans 10:9-10 just says, if we believe in our heart and confess with our mouth that Jesus is Lord, you will be saved. That's the easiest procedure. There's not a magical phrase, word, anything like that. But then I said, but then the Holy Spirit comes in and begins to work in your life and begins to reveal things that you may need to change in your life. It's going to change the way you see things. It's going to change your priorities. This dude's getting his PhD in math. So he's very intelligent, very brilliant guy. But he said, well, now you're making it sound like it's hard. And I said, let me make it clearer then. To become a follower of Jesus is easy. But to follow Jesus is going to be hard. And you need to take it with that weight, that it's going to be heavy. But there's new things that happen in your life. The Spirit's involved. The Spirit brings about his fruit in your life. A joy, peace, gentleness. Things begin to change. So, in case I've rambled too much for you today, let me try to put a in a box with a bow. Wrap it up for you. When we are faced with depressed thinking because of our circumstances, COVID, family, jobs, relationships, school, etc., I challenge us to remember our present living hope. Because of what God has done, we should bless God. I can give you this guarantee. If you will do this, everything about you changes. I can't guarantee it's going to change your circumstances, but I will guarantee it's going to change the way you look at your circumstances. I know all this sounds a little weird, folks, and blessing God will make my depressed thinking go away. Even if there is, again, that clinical or medical diagnosis, no matter where you are, no matter who you are, bless God because your life is in his hands. Okay, so we're going to do a little exercise. We're going to do an application right here, right now. I want you to vocally, so people can hear. We have microphones over the top of your heads, so people online will be able to hear you. I want you to shout out a blessing to God. What are you going to bless God right now? He is what? He's faithful. Go on. Sustainer.
Provider.
Provider.
Giver.
Protector. Giver. Creator. Yes. Love.
Healer.
Amen. Healer.
Redeemer.
Redeemer.
Deliver.
Deliver. He does bless us. Yes. Yeah. Amen. Thank you. If you don't know what we're talking about here, when it comes to being born again, but you understand that you're acting in rebellion to God and his commands, here is your cause. I was just saying this earlier. The cause is you're hearing the gospel right here, right now. Come up and talk with either myself or with staff or elders that are here. Your life will be forever changed. You will see things differently, and we can guarantee that. I'm going to pray, and then, Ron, let's do Living Hope again. Worship team, are you up for it? One more song? I think if you've paid attention at all, you'll sing this song with even an extra little spice to it, because it has a lot of the phrasing we use today. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for this opportunity today. We give you the blessing for your word. We give you the blessing for all you've done in our lives, for the hope that you give us. That, man, there are days that we're down. I've been there. I've gone through it. I continue to go back through it. It's always present. This world being cursed with sin is going to bring about that depressed feelings, thinking, full-on depression. I know for me, it's death. Losing a loved one to death stinks. But that's the curse of sin. But you give us a hope. You give us a living hope. So no matter what somebody's going through here this morning, you can have hope. If you're a follower of Jesus, you have hope right now. Lord, we ask the Spirit would be present, moving around, moving in us. We pray that you will call people to salvation right now, that they may know you and have that living hope. Just pray this in Jesus' name.
I'm going to invite you guys to stand back up. We're going to verse 3. to invite you this morning, if you don't know that hope that Dennis was talking about this morning, by all means, do not walk out of here without asking somebody first. Statistically, the church is filled with people that don't actually know who Jesus is. Which means you're here this morning. You know what church feels like. You know what church looks like. But you haven't actually stepped out of that tomb yet. You haven't accepted grace and mercy is offered to you. We're going to go into verse 3 again. And if you don't know that hope, almost, I dig your readiness. If you don't know that hope, now's the time. Someone in here whose heart you've been pulling at, that you don't let them walk away, that you make it so heavy they can't ignore you. God, we're thankful for the word this morning. We're thankful for this time for you, with you. Be with us throughout the rest of the week and bring us safely back next week, Lord. We pray this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ.